The soldier filming this is trapped. The woman and children he's looking at are not his family. And the house he's in is not his home. This house is in Vuhledar, a town in eastern Ukraine. The soldier belongs to the Black Beret Marines from Russia's elite 155th Brigade. Waves of men from this unit were sent to take Vuhledar last winter. But this small town soon turned into a death trap.
Да, палево, еба. Мы под такой обстрел попали. Столько трупов. Типов просто на две части разрывало возле меня. Я вообще в аху.
Within days of the assault, the soldiers raised the alarm. In a rare protest letter, they claimed that 300 men were killed, wounded, or went missing in 4 days. They also wrote that their commanders called them meat. They appealed for help from the man who championed them, their governor, Oleg Kozhemyako. But the man they had pinned their hopes on disputed their claims. So what happened in Vuhledar? People back home wanted answers. BBCI looked into the Black Berets' claims. It's difficult to interview soldiers or their families in Russia. They face years in jail for discrediting the army. But online, there's a trail of evidence. Piecing together online testimonies, death records, and battle footage, we found that the 155 did suffer heavy losses in Vuhledar. We found reasons why these men died.
Such kind of breaching operations are suicide.
And we found out what happened to those caught up in a battle. Ramaz Gorgadze was a stubborn young Russian. His mother says he was born this way. An iron character with Georgian roots. She says he was impossible to argue with. He grew up like any other young Russian in a small village called Yagodnaya, located in Russia's Far East province. As a young teenager, he developed a passion for rap. He took this passion with him during his 1 year national service. And became popular online for his talent. But in February 2022, Vladimir Putin, Russia's president, launched the full-scale invasion of Ukraine.
Мною принято решение о проведении специальной военной операции. Ее цель – защита людей, которые на протяжении 8 лет подвергаются издевательствам, геноциду со стороны киевского режима.
At first, professional soldiers were sent in. But by September, many of them had died. New blood was needed to refill the ranks. On September 21st, Putin announced a partial mobilization, calling up the men who had done their national service. The next day, the young rapper Ramaz posted his conscription notice on Instagram. He went to the mobilization point with his mother Svetlana and hugged her goodbye. Before leaving, he wrote a song about the war. But in Ramaz's head, it was not that simple. He told his mother that he had friends in Ukraine, and then the worst outcome would not be to die, but to shoot at people who are like him. Either way, his mind was made up. In late September, Ramaz left his home. Together with other men, he traveled more than 2,000 kilometers to a military base in the region of Primorye. There, he joined an elite unit, the Black Berets from the 155th Marine Brigade. Ukrainian authorities accused some of these men of war crimes in Bucha at the start of the war. This brigade is championed by Primorye's governor, Oleg Kozhemyako. Governors like him facilitated the mobilization across Russia, but Kozhemyako developed a reputation for being an enthusiastic recruiter.
Вы подготовленные бойцы, поэтому уверен, что сделаете все, всем, чтобы победа была за нами.
At the end of October, Ramaz completed his short training and was deployed to eastern Ukraine. He arrived in the town of Volnovakha, where the 155 was staged. On his journey, he sent updates to his mother.
Привет, мам, мы заехали в расположение. Подбиваем вещи, что есть, что нет. Пока не кормили, ничего пока не известно.
In Volnovakha, the 155 was preparing for an imminent offensive on the strategic town of Vuhledar. It sits on an elevated terrain in the Donetsk region of Donbass. Many Russian-speaking Ukrainians live in that area. These are the people Vladimir Putin vowed to liberate. Marina and her family had their home in Vuhledar.
Дом был красивый. Мы планировали все сами. Мы любили собирать гостей, любили эти сборища, любили общаться. Жизнь была очень хорошая. У нас были большие планы, понимаете, на город. Город наш развивался. Никто не мог поверить вообще, что это происходит действительно, что на нас напала уже Россия полномасштабно.
On October 28th, Ramaz and his comrades from the 155 prepared for the assault. He sent a last message to his mother, Svetlana.
Now we are moving to the checkpoints near the front line. Love you. Keep your fingers crossed. Don't worry too much. I'll be careful.
For days, the battle raged on. And by October 30th, the Russian Ministry of Defense announced that their troops had reached the southern outskirts of the village of Pavlivka, a town just south of Vuhledar. From the command post, this looked like a successful operation. Russia was gaining ground in Donbass. But on the battlefield, the Black Berets were not celebrating. They were caught in a death trap. Testimonies like this one started to emerge online.
Да, палево, мы под такой обстрел попали. Столько трупов, типов просто на две части разрывало возле меня. Я вообще в ахуе. Это хуже ада.
Ramaz, the young rapper from Yagodnaya, stopped sending news after the assault. His mother became worried and started looking for him. On Governor Kozhemyako's Telegram channel, other families complained directly to him. And on November 3rd, he received a message like no other. A letter addressed to him and written by the Black Berets themselves. The soldiers denounced being thrown into an incomprehensible offensive. They claimed that 300 men were killed, wounded, or went missing in 4 days. And they also wrote that their inept commanders called them meat. At the end, the Black Berets asked for an independent investigation. The letter went viral. 4 days later, the Russian Ministry of Defense issued a rare public denial. Governor Kozhemyako, the man the soldiers had pinned their hopes on, also responded to the appeal.
Команда не примет все меры для того, чтобы минимизировать эти потери, но мы со своей стороны будем дальше продолжать помогать нашим военнослужащим всем, чтобы как можно было меньше потерь обеспечить им необходимым снаряжением и оборудованием.
He added that he shared the letter with the military prosecutor's office, but he also denied the number of losses.
Вот, да, потери есть, идут тяжелые бои, вот, но они далеко не такие, как пишут в этом обращении.
Our investigation has uncovered evidence that supports the Black Berets' account. Russian authorities haven't released official data about casualties since September 2022. But BBC Russia's Olga Ivshina has the most accurate count available.
Since the first day of war, BBC Russian has been working together with independent website Mediazona and a team of volunteers to find out and confirm the number of Russian servicemen killed in Ukraine. We have been using open source material, official statements, social media posts, media reports and pictures from cemeteries within Russia.
We worked with this team to identify deaths in the 155 Brigade since the beginning of the war. When we plotted them on a graph, two clear spikes emerged in 2022. The first one represents the assault on Kyiv at the start of the conflict. But the highest one is in November 2022, during the offensive on Pavlivka and Vuhledar. We found that at least 60 Black Berets were killed or went missing in the month following the start of the assault on October 28th. Most happened after their letter was sent to Governor Kozhemyako.
We think that the real number of losses in 155 is definitely higher than the figure we have, because we can't always attribute certain people to the unit. And also, we only rely on open source material. So we believe that the real number of total losses on the Russian side is probably at least 2 times higher than the figure we have. So if we put aside the first 2 weeks of the invasion, which have seen a tremendous rate of losses, then this October and November battle for Pavlivka probably can be named as one of the highest concentration of losses for a single unit.
Why were the 155 losses so high in that time period? The Black Berets' letter mentions an incomprehensible offensive. They say their commanders planned to capture the town by rushing through woodlands where the enemy was waiting for them. They also claim the terrain made them easy targets for the Ukrainian gunnery. We analyzed hundreds of videos from the battles around Vuhledar. We found Russian troops making the errors described in the letter. These three videos, published days after the 155 letter, are clear examples. Shot from a Ukrainian reconnaissance drone, they show Russian attacks along the same road, entering Pavlivka from Yehorivka. It was widely reported that 155th led the assault on Pavlivka in early November, with the support of the 40th Marine Brigade and local forces. The first video shows two Russian BMP-3s attacking Pavlivka without any visible support. At the start of the video, one BMP-3 is hit, Despite this, the two vehicles keep going. They reach the first houses and stop here. The soldiers disembark and take up position. But they don't know that this drone is watching them. Later, the camera zooms out and they're struck by Ukrainian artillery. In the second video, a Russian T-80BV tank attempts a breakthrough on its own, on the same road. Again, a drone sees it coming. The tank is hit once, but keeps going, running into the remains of another Russian vehicle. It then stops, and the Ukrainians take it out. The third video shows another lone Russian tank, again rushing through the same road. A missile nearly hits the tank, but it keeps going and drives by the remains of the two vehicles we've seen before. The tank is then struck and hits the tree line. Tayfun Özberk was a Turkish naval officer for 16 years. He worked alongside Russian Marines on Operation Black Sea Harmony in 2004. We showed him videos of the battle to understand the Russian behavior on the field.
You see that location was hit.
And for him, these images reflect a glaring lack of military tactics.
They didn't apply the fundamentals of land warfare in these videos. And they're just sending the troops from a narrow line to the death. There is only one line. So the Ukrainian gunnery knows where to shoot. They are easy targets.
According to Tayfun, these types of assaults need careful planning to succeed.
Going out of the road.
Other parts of the land probably was mined by the Ukrainian forces. So after clearing mines, you replan your course of action, but this time from multiple lines.
Multiple lines of attack allow units in the field to take out the enemy's defenses.
Without mine clearance operation, without air reconnaissance operation, without enough intelligence supported with thermal and other electro-optical imaging, such kind of breaching operations are suicide.
Tayfun's analysis tells us that the 155 soldiers were not capable of proper reconnaissance. Our investigation found one of the reasons why this may have happened. They were missing critical equipment. On October 11th, weeks before the assault on Vuhledar, Governor Kozhemyako said he would deliver reconnaissance devices to the 155.
Это прицелы тепловизионные, вот коллиматорные, кронштейны к ним, там 1041. Сейчас тепловизионные приборы и прицелы направляем более 300.
But on the ground, the soldiers said they lacked equipment. We've talked to a Russian source with friends in the 155.
Our guys were sent without drones, without support, without tanks, without anything. They sent infantry against artillery.
The Black Berets turned to their families for help. On October 30th, a group of mothers and wives of Primorye soldiers sent a message on Telegram, collecting money to buy thermal imager and components. The appeal said the 155th reconnaissance team needed it. And the name on the appeal matches a name we found in a leaked list of soldiers. A soldier from the 155th Brigade with 10 years of experience. On Kozhemyako's Telegram channel, we found more than 10 messages from families complaining about equipment or appealing for it.
This is quite unusual. It's not common to see the families of the soldiers appealing some equipment from the company. This is, I don't want to say embarrassing, but it is for any commander.
On December 14th, 5 weeks after the Black Berets appealed to their governor, the military prosecutor published the conclusion of their investigation. They found no wrongdoing by the 155th Brigade's commanders. By December, Ramaz, the young rapper from Yagodnaya, was still missing. His mother, Svetlana, shared her despair online and asked for help to find him. Back in October, Governor Kozhemyako had promised to support the families. He wrote this on Telegram.
In each municipality, hotlines and support centers have been created, where relatives and friends can turn to for any issue.
But families sent messages on his channel saying they could not get responses.
I called the hotline. They asked for a power of attorney from my husband. But where am I going to get it? Should I run to the front line?
And run to the front line is exactly what Ramaz's mother did. Following the footsteps of her son, she said online her family traveled nearly 7,000 kilometers to the town of Volnovakha, where her son was last seen before the assault on Vuhledar in October. There, she finally found her answer. Her son was dead. He had been killed in the battle. We found an account of what happened to Ramaz. On the day of the assault, his squad moved into a house. Ramaz was panicked. 10 minutes into the battle, a drone strike on the house ripped off Ramaz's legs. He later died from his injuries, a day before his comrades sent their protest letter to Governor Kozhemyako. Over the next months, Ramaz's mother grieved her son. She also talked to local media. In late January 2023, Russia tried to take Vuhledar again, launching the largest assault on the town since the beginning of the war. Again, soldiers of the 155th Brigade were involved. Again, the men were caught in a death trap. Again, they raised the alarm. On January 29th, another letter from the Black Berets appeared on Governor Kozhemyako's Telegram group. The soldiers said they lost almost the entire personnel of the battalion. They warned of a repetition of Pavlivka's battle, and that they're now threatened with criminal prosecution in cases of disobedience. In the days after the letter, more videos surfaced showing the same tactical mistakes as the footage from October and November. Lone Russian units attacking in a single line and getting hit repeatedly. 13 days after the 155 second letter, a journalist asked President Putin about the fate of the Russian Marines in Ukraine. This is his response.
Пехота морская. Работает как с ней. Прямо сейчас. Героически сражаются. И Тихоокеанская, Тихоокеанского флота и Северного.
And Governor Kozhemyako? He never replied to the second letter. We contacted Governor Kozhemyako for a comment on our findings. He did not respond. President Putin and Governor Kozhemyako have justified the war as a liberation of the Russian-speaking people in eastern Ukraine. Marina, the resident from Vuhledar, sees it differently.
Ми не притіснені. Нас не треба освобождати. Нас освободили від нормальної життя, від роботи, від сім'ї.
Marina left her home in Vuhledar at the start of the war. She watched the battle unfold on social media. On Telegram, she saw this video of 155 soldiers fighting in her house.
Это мой дом. Я понимаю уже все. Я вижу эти фотографии, которые лежат в диване, кто их положил.
Красиво.
Это жутко просто. Я понимаю, что это самое ценное лежит там, и я не могу его забрать.
One year later, Marina's home in Vuhledar, or what's left of it, is still a contested battlefield. Having to rely on public online evidence means we may never know the full extent of 155 deaths in Vuhledar. But our investigation shows that tactical mistakes and a lack of proper equipment led to one of the highest known concentrations of losses in the war for a single unit. As the Black Berets warned us in both their protest letters. 1 year later, Russia is still sending men to try and take the town. Young men like Ramaz Gorgadze. But this battle is just one story. Bakhmut, Kupiansk, Avdiivka. More and more young men are being thrown into Russia's meat grinder.